So far, I'm fairly impressed with the start of the Holy War. I give you that, Nakaba-sensei. You've done a good job with this chapter. I especially love the artwork. It's pretty beautiful. I just love, like, the double-page panels and stuff, seeing the entire army go in at each other. I especially love, like, when the chapter starts and you see the horses charging in up against the demons. Just really nice artwork in this chapter. I just want to take a few moments to compliment that. Just good stuff, Nakaba-sensei. I mean, if there is definitely one big thing I've always loved about arcs like this when it comes to shonen or any type of manga, is that typically you can find some really good panels, and I'm expecting a lot more high-quality panels in the future. But anyways, though, what I'm truly impressed with is that how this chapter shows that everybody's life is on the line and how the cards are stacked against our side, our main characters, or at the very least, the human side, the angel side, or goddess side, that it's stacked against them. And the reason why is because they are under the control of Rudisil. We get to see Death Pierce and a couple other Holy Knots and many others do things that is just not right at all. Completely disgusting, and it just is like, oh my god, like they're no longer normal anymore. When you see Death Pierce just get crushed and all that in this chapter, and you see him looking at himself, it took me a moment to really realize what was wrong with him, and to start really analyzing the page. I'm like, his fingers are going backwards. Like, his fingers are bending in different directions. I'm like, I don't think fingers are supposed to bend that way. And you just look at his face and all that, and when you see some get up and their arms are all broken like this, I'm like, oh my god, they're like zombies. Like, Rudisil's, you know, manipulation, mind control, it looks like he legit turned them into mindless zombies. And judging by what Death Pierce said in this chapter, is that he apparently has removed their feeling of pain. So he is not just, in fact, brainwashed them to fight for the Goddess Clan, but he's also made it to where they can't really experience pain. Like, Death Pierce's like, I don't feel anything. This must be the blessing of, you know, Rudisil's divine protection. I'm like, oh my god. They will continue moving forward even if their legs or limbs get blown off. They will continue moving forward, which is just, okay, I see a lot of death. If you lack the ability to feel pain, then you won't really know if something's going wrong. For instance, if your body is missing something, like let's say you're missing half of your foot, okay? You're going to start bleeding quite a bit, okay? And if you have holes in your body, you're going to bleed all over the place. But if you can't feel the pain, you don't know about it, or you can't feel your bones broken or shattered, then obviously it's going to come to a point to where your body's just going to auto-shut down. Like, that's what I feel like is going to happen to Death Pierce and all the other Holy Knights. They're getting crunched and all that. They're getting back up. But it's just only a matter of time to where their body can no longer take it. For instance, they may think they're okay, but they're just tricking their brain right now. Once they find out, or their brain just no longer can take it, or their body can take it, it's just going to shut everything off. They're just going to collapse down and die. And that's what is scary about this, because they're just throwing themselves out there like meat up against like a meat grinder, and they don't even care about their own lives because they think they're fine. They think they're not taking any damage, which is just like, it's insane. And so this is the scary thing about war, especially something like this, is just they don't give a crap about their own life with them just charging in endlessly like they were in this chapter. If they continue to do something like that, the forces on the goddess side, they're just going to drain down very quickly, because with how the demon side, they outnumber, you know, humanity. Now there's a lot more higher level demons and stuff than normal humans. There's just no way that they're going to be able to put up a fight, even if they endlessly and recklessly charge them. It's just going to make their numbers get lower and lower, and they're just going to hit to zero, and the demons are just going to swarm them. So mainly what this is right now a very unwise tactic. It's just mainly them being fodder, just going out there, being meat shields, and just dropping dead. It's a lot of casualties. And it seems like Rudisil, once again, just does not care about any other race besides his own neck and the Goddess Clan for him to do something as heinous as that. Now, let's talk about the other stuff of this chapter. So, we get to see the improvements of Diane and King's power. As we know, they've gotten a power up very recently. They finally, you know, have showcased that they're willing to take on the mantle of, you know, the next Giant King or Giant Queen and the Fairy King. And you see how Diane, she comes into this chapter riding like an earth tidal wave. And I'm like, yo, it's called Queen's Embrace or a Queen's Empress, one of those two. And it's just, it's really epic looking. I love the zoom out that Nakama Sensei did in this chapter when he showed Diane just riding it. It just really shows like the scale of how massive that is. Because Diane, she's pretty big, okay? She's pretty big. She's a giant. And she looked tiny on that giant wave coming in. So you got to imagine how massive that wave was. Imagine people looking up, regular humans just looking up at that, how scary that looks. So, yeah, I really like the size and scale comparison of that part in this chapter, just showing how much Diane is able to control now. The earth she's able to control and manipulate, she has definitely moved up quite a bit. Now, King also showcases he has gotten a lot stronger with his sacred treasure and his abilities as well. When he launches one of his abilities and he hits the Albions, and you see them just shatter and explode, and you're like, oh my god. Like, I mean, we always known that King could wipe them out. We saw him fight one already in season 2 of the anime. We know he can fight Albions, but seeing how he just effortlessly just took care of them like it was nothing, it just shows how strong he really is. He is definitely not weak by any means. He has definitely improved quite a bit. So I just like that. I like getting to see their show of strength and how much they have definitely improved. We also get to see the two, you know, archangels and how they're able to just completely obliterate, you know, a lot of demons on the battlefield too, but just using Omega Arc, which once again puts into comparison how insanely OP the archangels are. We know they're very strong. They're like the equivalent of the Ten Commandments, but on the goddess side, so they're definitely not gonna go down with ease. And judging by the way this chapter is being set up, something is telling me that these two archangels are probably going to be going after Esterhazy. Like, they're going to be getting in a fight with him very soon. So let's move into the next segment, okay? Because I think this is the perfect time to talk about, you know, Esterhazy and what's going on with Mon and Derriere and then what the two archangels are going to do. So the second half of the chapter, we get to see how outsiders, you know, regular humans that are just civilians, you know, in town or whatever, how they're seeing just these demons pour in, going through the country, how massive they are. Everybody's just freaking out. And it's for good reason. I mean, if you saw an army of demons outside your village walking and marching, you would get scared, really, really scared. And so they're like, this must be the end of the world. They're wanting to run. Everybody's just wanting to book it and evacuate, which, like I said, makes complete sense. And as we know, the village that's talking about this is the village that Mon and Derriere have been staying in. Now, as we know, Mon and Derriere, they no longer really want to be a part of the whole thing with the Holy War. They don't want to be a part of the dispute between the goddess and demon clan. They just want to live their own life. They just want to be happy by themselves. And I you know what? I commend them for that. I'm glad that they're going after what they want to do. And you see how Mon's getting very sentimental. He's like, you know, I just want to enjoy my life with you right now. You know, spend time with you. I've been enjoying this lifestyle we've had. And it's very sweet. Just shows once again how much he really cares about her and how he wants to be with her. And Derriere's like, you know what? Let's turn our commandments back into Zeldris. Let's give him our commandments, and we can just, you know, move on with our lives. And knowing how Zeldris is, I do believe that he would willingly allow them to give up their commandments, and he would not even kill them, even before Meliodas came into the picture. You know how Meliodas is in the picture now? I think even if Meliodas was in the picture, if Derriere and Mon just came up to him and was like, could you have our commandments before we can just live our lives? I think he'd be fine with it, because Zeldris, we knew he was in a relationship with one of the vampires. He lost her, obviously, thanks to Meliodas. And I just feel like he would be able to comprehend the fact of someone loving someone, especially like Mon loving Derriere, Derriere loving Mon. I feel like he would be able to comprehend that. So I just don't think he'd be that malicious at all. And so I think they would be off relatively easy. They'll be able to live on with their lives. However, Esterhazy, he's a different story. Esterhazy has actually found Derriere and Mon in this chapter. Now, as we know, Mon and Derriere, they're not weak. By any means, they are not weaklings, okay? They are still, at this moment, 10 commandments. They have their commandments still, okay? We know this. But even though they still have their commandments, Esterhazy, he has a couple of commandments already in his possession. We know this, thanks to what he did to, you know, Galan. So, this lets us know that he is definitely stronger than a normal commandment now. So, it's definitely going to be a hard fight for Derriere and for Mon to fight up against him. And I do believe if things do get hectic and all that, I can definitely see the two other archangels that were in this chapter finding Esther Rosa and fighting the man. I could definitely see that, and seeing how they might be able to save Darrier and Mon as well. I mean, I know that they're goddesses and all that, but we have seen how they were always talking with Elizabeth, how they sided with Elizabeth in the flashback. So they're not completely evil. We know for a fact they're not. They do have a good side to them. So I do want to point out that there is a likely possibility that Darrier and Mon are going to get in a fight with Esther Rosa, and then the two archangels are going to pop up, probably save them, and there you go. Or another thing that could happen is the girl that has been, taking care of Darrier and Mon, she might try to sacrifice her life for them, and, she dies for them, which could, put them over the edge. I could definitely see something along those lines happening. But that's about it when it comes to this chapter, so let me know your thoughts in the comments below. If you enjoy my content, please subscribe. If you like this video, please leave a like, and I love you guys. Please be safe. Chibi out.